Good evening. 4 weeks ago, we were about to enter into discussion when I was unfortunately had to rush home. The subject was the militias and martial law and the federal government. Fortunately, in the intervening time, I had an opportunity to do rather a dry run. I taught this subject at Constitution Day on September 17th. If you remember, 4 weeks ago, the beginning of the discussion was, what is martial law? Because most people have no idea what martial law is. They think that police and riot gear is martial law, and curfews are martial law. Martial law actually has a meaning. Martial meaning military. And so it's military law. Representative McLean properly pointed out that it's when the military is the first group responsible for enforcing civilian law. That is the particular definition of martial law. When the military is the first group responsible for enforcing civilian law. Martial law is what you have on a battlefield, for instance. The military is there, they're engaged, and they, when they see somebody doing something, stealing, whatever, they are the ones who do the interdiction. As opposed to ordinary civilian law, when police are the ones enforcing civilian law, and if, for instance, you have a state of emergency, which is not martial law, it's a state of emergency, and you have the National Guard out, it's the military, it's the civilian police who enforce the law with the assistance of the military, whether it's the National Guard, State Guard, they are in an assistance mode. When you have martial law, it's the military that is enforcing the law, and they are assisted by the civilian police. And typically what happens is you're in the middle of a situation, they interdict somebody breaking the laws of the state or of the United States. They arrest the individual. They determine if this individual is a civilian or a combatant. If they're a combatant, they stay under military jurisdiction. If they're a civilian, they're turned over to civilian authorities.
But they're still enforcing civilian law.
They're still enforcing civilian law. Now, this brings us to the question, who has the power to declare martial law in the state of New Hampshire? Now, we had the first article we see in this regard, first, the militia, is part two, article 20, I'm sorry, part one, article 24, I believe. Article 24, a well-regulated militia is the proper, natural, and sure defense of the state. Does that sound like something you see anywhere else?
That's the Second Amendment.
No, that was Article 24. Remember, what came first? The state constitution came first. The Second Amendment echoes what's in the state constitutions and says the proper defense, I gotta get right to it, there we go, Article. Second Amendment is, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. So, what is the action of the Second Amendment is not particularly to looking to protect individual rights, but by protecting individual rights, you protect the state's capacity to have a militia. If the federal government could disarm the people, they deprive the states of their militias.
Which thing are you talking about, the U.S. Constitution or the state?
Well, the U.S. Constitution, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms should not be infringed. That is particularly so, the federal government cannot deprive the states of their militias. Because if you go back to the laws of the founding period, one of the things you see is everybody, and that's one of the things I don't have with me, But I've come back and I've studied the militia laws back to 1776 and actually back to 1689. The militia laws of 1776, first of all, very boldly state that New Hampshire considers itself to be a nation. One of the reasons that they have the militia is that a nation needs to defend itself. It has the obligation to defend itself from all comers. It then goes on to require everybody between the ages of 16 and 60 to be in the militia. There are two orders of the militia. The first order of the militia was known as the training.
It was still the state, but
it was still the state. This is the state laws of 1776. And this is the way it ran up until the 1850s. The training, everybody between 16 and 60, or later 16 and 40, who was not in an exempt profession, millers, teachers, preachers, members of government, ferrymen, those people were all exempt from being in the training band. But everybody else was required to be in the training band, the first order of the militia. Then they had the alarm list. Everybody who wasn't in the training band and wasn't a conscientious objector, read Quaker, was required to be in the alarm list. And everybody, training band and alarm list, was required to own a firearm. After 1784, they got very specific about the barrel length of the rifle. You had to have a hatchet or a sword, a jackknife, a rucksack, a bedroll, a one-quart canteen. You had to have 3 days rations in your rucksack. You had to have a haversack, which is where you carry your ammunition, with I can't remember how many cartouches of ammunition and powder, which is it's prepackaged shot and powder to drop right down your rifle barrel.
What and why was the specific barrel?
I would presume to be competitive with what was in the military. One of the other things is in 1776 there was no requirement to have a bayonet, but after 1784 you were required to have a bayonet. So really you were required to have the same armaments as any soldier in the regular military.
Was this true without the station?
It was generally true of all the states. I mean, they would have different specifications on the accoutrements, but that you had to be properly equipped was very uniform. So when the federal constitution says that the federal government can't deprive the people of the right to keep and bear arms, it's so that they can comply with state law and be properly armed and equipped to hit the field at a moment's notice. Another popular misconception is that somehow these militias were self-organized. They were not, never were, no how, no way. The Constitution of 1776 says that the House and Council will commission all officers, and that the officers will report to them. Later, when we get to 1784, it's the governor who commissions the officers. But it was always strictly under the control of the civilian government. It was never a self-organized entity. The closest you came to that was from 1776 to 1784, while the officers were appointed by the legislature, the non-commissioned officers were nominated by their men and approved by the company officers. So it still wasn't, you know, just who bought you the most drinks on Saturday night.
So it's your belief then, Dan, that the federal constitution, that amendment, came from the state, and there were other states aside from New Hampshire that had similar militia provisions?
All of them. All of them.
So one of the things that I hear a lot today, when you get to the federal constitution, and you talk about the Second Amendment, in fact, I heard Andrew Cuomo, the governor of New York, talk about it a few years back. You know, show me where you need to have this weapon to go deer hunting. Okay? And obviously that's not the intention of the Second Amendment. But there's this debate that goes on about what is the intention of it at the federal level. In any of these state constitutions, because there were many of them, is that clearly spelled out anywhere?
It's clearly spelled out. The arms are not necessarily spelled out in the Constitution. They're spelled out in statute.
But the intent.
But the intent is spelled out, I believe, in all of them, to varying degrees. Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Pennsylvania, and Maryland had very detailed bills of rights and described it very clearly. Others like Georgia and New Jersey were much less articulate in their constitutions. But they all had, and they all had the legislatures reporting to the, the militias reporting to the legislature.
Okay, so when they were developing the Bill of Rights, for example, and talk about the Second Amendment, they were working from something which had been already embedded in the country, in all the states.
Yes.
Okay, now, so if we were to look at original intent, they must have meant something by the U.S. Second Amendment that somehow or other reflected what had gone on in the states.
Well, absolutely. One of the fun things is, I don't have, unfortunately, Federalist Paper 28. The Federalist Paper 28 was written by Hamilton. And he describes in the last two or three paragraphs of Federalist 28 how the federal government would never be able to practice tyranny upon the states because the state legislatures would perceive it, and you have the militias with officered by men chosen from among them by their governor whom they are attached, and then he gives a battle plan for the states against the federal government. He says, the federal government attacks Massachusetts. Well, then if Massachusetts gets beaten down, then a state from the other end, like South Carolina, can attack the federal government from the rear, giving Massachusetts a chance to recover. And so there's no way that the federal government would ever be able to defeat the states. I do have Federalist Paper 46, which is written by Madison. And it's amazingly prescient, but it's also speaks to the same thing. Extravagant as the supposition is, let it, however, be made, let a regular army fully equal to the resources of a country be formed, and let it be entirely at the devotion of the federal government. Still, it would not be going too far to say that the state governments, with the people on their side, would be able to repel the danger. The highest number which, according to the best computation, a standing army can be carried in any country does not exceed 1/100th part of the whole number of souls, or 1/25th part of the number of able to bear arms. This proportion would not yield in the United States an army of more than 20,000 or 30,000 men. To these would be opposed militia numbering near 500,000 citizens, with arms in their hands, officered by men chosen from among themselves, fighting for their common liberties and united and conducted by governments possessing their affections and confidence. It may well be doubted whether a militia thus circumstanced could ever be conquered by a proportion of regular troops. Those who are best acquainted with the last successful resistance of this country against British arms will be most inclined to deny the possibility of it. Besides the advantage of being armed, which Americans possess over the people of almost every other nation, the existence of subordinate governments to which the people are attached and by which the militia officers are appointed form a barrier against enterprises of ambition more insurmountable than that which any simple government of any form can admit. That's how the founders viewed the relationship between the states and the general government. And the calculation is really quite amazing. We have approximately 350 million people in the United States today. And what is the largest the army has been in the last several years, from including regular troops, reserve officers, National Guard? Approximately 3 million. We have not been able to sustain more than 1% of the general population. Madison's number is still spot on.
And because they can't maintain, they have to hire contractors. Blackwater. Or
but even that, it doesn't bring the number up sufficiently to be able to circumstance themselves against the states.
Well, let me ask a general question. Okay, so that's how it started. There haven't been any more amendments to the Constitution that affected. Has there been anything in the law or practice that have changed that situation?
Which situation?
Of how the authority to do these things, that it comes from basically from the states organizing it and the federal government saying, well, that's okay.
Well, the federal government doesn't have to say that's okay. The federal government is not allowed to say it isn't okay. That's what the Second Amendment says. But yes, 23 of the 50 states, I believe it's 23, have state guards.
A state what?
Guard.
Guard. Mm-hmm.
Okay, a state guard is a state defense force. Numbered among those 23 states are Massachusetts, New York, and Vermont. Vermont formed their state guard in, I think, 2003 after 9/11, pursuant to 9/11.
I guess the question, I guess I didn't ask it right. When they get into these arguments, as we do about the Second Amendment, you are talking about how it got there. And my question is, has there something that's happened legally, legislatively, or practically, or anything that has changed that essential layout?
Well, it can't happen legislatively.
Right.
Remember that the Constitution sets the bounds under which legislation may be made.
Correct.
So it can't happen legislatively. You're right, there's been no amendments. The most substantial thing relative to this whole concept is the Dick Act of 1913, which occurred after the Spanish-American War, because they realized that some states had converted their militias to what were called National Guards, and they had sent state militias to Cuba, etc., and then realized that that was unconstitutional. So pursuant to the Dick Act, pursuant to the Spanish-American War, they passed the Dick Act, which created this hybrid thing of National Guards, which functioned partially as a state militia and partially as a national reserve force. And then the states were also authorized under the Dick Act to create state defense forces. And we have in our statutes today, whenever the National Guard is out of the state, the governor has the authority to establish an officer corps for the state guard, which I believe should be mandatory and not conditional.
What? You said what is what?
Well, I said that
the last sentence you just said, which you were sort of
which I believe should be mandatory and not optional. Think about if the proper defense of a free state is a well-regulated militia. Does the legislature have any legitimate? Is the legislature irresponsible not to require the establishment of a well-regulated militia for the defense of the state?
Depends on the definition of well-regulated.
Well, in the intent of well-regulated means that you know you practice and you know your chain of command. I mean, military forces being what they are. That's one of the other funny things is in the call for the convention in 1781, where they were doing something more substantial in reorganizing the state constitution, one of the things that went in there was the fact that they were, that the non-commissioned officers were no longer going to be nominated by the men of the company, because they had seen what a failure that had been during the War for Independence, because you had a lot of people nominated to run platoons and squads that were not militarily competent. They were just the guy who bought the most drinks on Saturday night. And you know, you had a lot of men get killed that way. And so it became clear to them that no, this should really be based upon the judgment of the company officers and whom they thought was really competent to nominate the men or to promote the men.
Well, I guess what my earlier question was, when we hear all these arguments about the Second Amendment, you've given us a basis for understanding it. Has anything happened?
No.
Additionally, in other words, that no. is still the basis.
That is still the basis. There's been no changes to the Constitution. The only thing that's changed in the New Hampshire, there's been a change in the New Hampshire Constitution. Originally, the right to keep and bear arms was merely implicit in Part 1, Article 2. All men have certain natural, essential, and inherent rights, among which are enjoying and defending life and liberty and acquiring, possessing, and protecting property. Well, you can't defend life and liberty and protect property unless you have the arms to do so. So it's implicit. And we know that the state laws of the period when that was, right after that was written, required everybody to own arms. But in 1981, Crow Dickinson, who was still serving in the legislature when I first got there, was seeing the encroachments upon the right to keep and bear arms by the state and federal government, and so he had added to that Article 2A. All persons have the right to keep and bear arms in defense of themselves, their families, their property, and the state. Which is almost a perfect copy of what was in the Pennsylvania Constitution in 1776.
It is stunning to me that it is only that recently that the electorate still understood that.
Yes.
Are you implying that they now understand it? Because this is news to me.
No, they don't now, but it was that recently. That was ratified by the people in 1982.
Can you imagine the right to keep and bear arms in New Hampshire was acknowledged, not by the legislature, by the people as recently as the early 80s? That is stunning to me that still happened.
Go
ahead.
If Madison is making the argument in Federalist 46 that, you know, to get out of hand, this state is going to come in and it will defend itself against the federal government, and okay, so Massachusetts is defending itself, maybe not doing well, South Carolina.
That argument's actually made by Hamilton in 28, but yes.
Oh, okay, so. So if they're making that assertion, obviously the implication is that these militias are armed with power commensurate to the federal army. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
And if you are tying your right to bear arms to be able to provide weapons into that militia system, what is the argument that the National Firearms Act of 1934 would be deemed constitutional? Because there are limits. We do have restricted weapons.
Yep.
And yet, if that's the case, and you just had a militia, that militia would be denied.
Well, it depends on particular. For instance, most people didn't have cannons in their backyard in the constitutional period.
But they could.
But they could.
They could, but those implements would have been in the hands of the town, for instance, because each town had a company. So the larger implements, you know, everybody had to have so many cartouches in their haversack and so much powder and so much shot that they carried with them. But the town also had to keep a store of shot and powder. Above and beyond what the individuals kept.
But that's, I can't buy hand grenades.
No, you can't, but in theory, if you had a constitutional militia operating, you would have, everybody would have be required to own their personal weapons, and then you would have a local armory that would have all the heavier equipment necessary to defend whatever region it was designed to defend.
But that is not explicit in any of these constitutions.
No.
That's what that divided line is.
No, that will not be divided. That would be established by state law. One of the things there's a number, again, I don't have it with me because I don't have it with me, I guess. But there are several articles under the governor's power, and unfortunately the Constitution doesn't really say what they were, but Article 53, militia officers removal. Now, all these were repealed in 1976 after the National Guard had really come to the forefront. Staff and non-commissioned officers whom appointed by, well, that's that article said that, you know, the governor and council commissioned officers, and then the non-commissioned officers were put in place by the company officers. Division of militia into brigades, Article 55, division of militia into brigades, regiments, and companies. So the Constitution organized the military structure of the state. Accounts of military stores. Every 6 months, the adjutant general had to give the governor an account of all the military stores in the state. Those have all been repealed, but those were part of the constitutional structure. So,
but they did not, they still did not limit what could be possessed by a private citizen.
No, they did not. They just said that, you know, inform the governor what and where the military supplies were, so that he knew whether or not the state was adequately supplied.
But you're saying in 1976 it was the National Guard that came into existence?
No, came into the fort, really got overshadowed the State Guard. We had a State Guard in existence from about 1915 through 1954. Then it got disbanded, and the National Guard really eclipsed it. And by 1976, those articles were seen as superfluous. And so they were repealed.
Part of my ignorance of the National Guard, I know that the governor has some authority, but is there a federal structure? It's called the National Guard, so.
There's two structures. There. When, under certain circumstances, the national government can federalize the National Guard. At all other times, the National Guard is under the command of each state's government. And there's an adjutant general in every state who's the chief military officer.
So if, in a time of tension, New Hampshire decided it was going to enter into conflict with the United States, mm-hmm. and the United States chose to federalize the New Hampshire National Guard.
Oops!
There you go. How does that go? How does that scenario play out?
Well, that would not be unlike what happened with the militias in 1776. Remember why the people rolled a cannon up to Governor Wentworth's door in Portsmouth in July of 75? Because he was harboring a loyalist militia officer. One of the things that happened in 1776 is all these militia officers, okay, John Langdon, you've heard his name, John Sullivan, you've heard his name, they were all captains in the state militia. So all of a sudden this conflict arises, they have to decide whether they're going to honor their oath to the king or honor that portion of the oath which says their purpose is to protect the people. And they split about 50-50. Rogers Rangers, Queen's Militia, went with the king. Most, about half of the militia officers went with the people in the Congress. So it becomes a personal decision at that point.
So if there was a situation where 100% of the folks decided they were going to go with the federal government, that is when, because the people have the right to bear arms,
right?
But we'd be at this moment.
Yeah.
We would be at a substantial disadvantage because we have no command structure. We have no commissioned officers. There is nobody who has any particular authority. That's why you want a well-regulated militia.
I would offer that those individuals would step up, whether it's whoever, oath keepers, ex-military,
and
whatever.
You have to hope they do, and you have to hope they're competent, and you have to hope they have the right loyalties, and they're not interested, and it's not personal ambition.
And but the more critical issue is the fact that the federal government has convinced everybody that there's an except clause after shall not be infringed.
Right.
If you do not, as in 1776, when the colonists had identical armament, that doesn't exist anymore.
No. Now here's another. Now here's the next thought. Okay. Now we know what the militia is, and we know what martial law is. Who has the power to declare martial law in the state of New Hampshire? Any volunteers?
That would be the governor. Council.
And who did you say?
The legislature.
He got it right.
Who?
The legislature. It is not the governor and council. Part 2, Article 25, just one beyond the militia. I think it's, no, I'm sorry, it's 34. Part 1, Article 34, Militia Law Limited. Well, that, remember, that title doesn't really exist. It's an editor's note from 1841. But Article 34, no person can in any case be subjected to martial law or to the pains and penalties by virtue of that law except those employed in the Army or Navy and except the militia in actual service but by authority of the legislature. So only the legislature can declare martial law in our government. Does the general government, the government of the United States, have any power to declare martial law?
I don't recall seeing one.
No. The term martial law never appears in the Constitution for the United States. What there is a power to declare war, which is in fact particularly denied to the states. Now, if you have a declared war and you have a recognized battlefield, martial law exists on that battlefield by default. That is just the way war is. Once you have a battlefield, you have martial law. The states are not allowed to declare war. They are allowed to defend themselves if invaded or attacked. And they are allowed to declare martial law within their borders. Now, if there's been no declared war, and the government of the United States, again, only the just a kind of a parallel here, only the legislature of New Hampshire can declare martial law in New Hampshire. Only the federal legislature can declare war. The president can't declare war. Now, if we should suddenly find ourselves where somebody says, and I won't say who, because it doesn't matter who, if somebody says, that there's martial law, somebody other than the legislature says that there is martial law in New Hampshire, what does that mean? And there's no declared war. What is the implication?
It means if you don't get shot, you can fight it out in court, bucko.
I would say more particularly, it means that they have declared war upon the state. By default. If the only way you can have martial law is in a battlefield, if the only way the federal government can have martial law is in a battlefield, and they declare martial law in a state, they have by default declared war upon that state.
Are there any states where the executive in that state has the power?
Not to the best of my knowledge. Not constitutionally.
They don't have, so there's no state that has...
That says the governor can declare martial law.
Constitutionally.
Not that I know of. And if the legislature, and this is an important concept from Locke, it's called the non-delegation doctrine. The legislature has been authorized to make law, not to make legislatures. There is nothing in our constitutions, nothing in the concept of locking a social contract that authorizes the legislature to make legislators.
Meaning appoint legislators.
Meaning create some other body to act, to do the function of legislators.
Like the EPA or the FDA or the DEA.
There's no power to tell some other body to make rules. Now, you could tell the DES to propose laws for us to pass, because you're so expert, you know what should be done, bring it back to us, we'll debate it and pass a law. But to give DES or Department of Ed the power to make rules with the force and effect of law is an unlawful delegation. So, for instance, if the state constitution says only the legislature shall declare martial law, the legislature can't give the governor the power to declare martial law. That would be an unlawful delegation of power.
But the governor could pass the legislature.
Absolutely. Governor could call the legislature into special session. We have an emergency. I need you to declare martial law. And the legislature could then do so, or debate it and not. Similar to that, habeas corpus, the right to see the body, the right to if somebody's incarcerated, for their attorney to demand to see them. Who can declare that in the state of New Hampshire? Any guesses?
You wiped us out.
The legislature, part two, article, I think it's 90, it's close, it's in that area.
You mean all 400 of them?
All four, well, at least 201. Or a majority of those present and voting, as they say.
Assuming Lincoln hasn't arrested them all.
Article 91. The privilege and benefit of habeas corpus shall be enjoyed in this state in the most free, easy, cheap, and expeditious and ample manner, and shall not be suspended but by the legislature upon the most urgent and pressing occasions, and for a time not to exceed 3 months. So even we can't suspend habeas corpus for more than 90 days at a time, and then we have to go back and revisit it. And these are really important concepts when you're dealing with. I mean, I don't think we ever contemplated this prior to the last maybe 10, 15 years. But when you have the very real circumstance of the type of actions that were carried out in Louisiana after Katrina, and what we all fear may happen today, knowing who has legitimate authority to suspend the normal course of law is extremely important, because you have to know when somebody is doing it unlawfully. I'm very uncomfortable with the governor having the power to declare a state of emergency.
There's where I was going.
It isn't really suspending habeas corpus, because it isn't, you know, it isn't incarcerating, you know, throwing people into a black hole and not letting them see their attorney. However, in September of 2014, the governor declared a state of emergency and seized property that was lawful to own. We had the opioid epidemic, and therefore she seized synthetic marijuana that was being sold in convenience stores.
Is there a constitutional definition of property that is unlawful to own?
No, but the states are considered, there's no particular prohibition on the states to not prohibit certain property. So you have to, and we are given broad authority to make laws that are wholesome and necessary for the safety and security of the state. So, could we make such a law? Yeah, states in the late 1890s, late 19th century, a lot of states enacted prohibition and required no constitutional amendments to do so, because it was within their broad police powers. However, most of them found it to be unprofitable, and. In many states, including New Hampshire, prohibition was repealed before it was enacted nationally, because it just didn't work. I think New Hampshire had prohibition for about 10 years starting in the 1890s. I can't remember exactly how long it, but we repealed it before it was ever enacted nationally. And it was not perceived that we needed an amendment to have that power to do so. So does, in the broadest sense, does the state have the power to prohibit ownership of certain property? Yeah. But the governor doesn't have the power to do so unilaterally. Such laws have to be enacted by constitutionally. By the legislature, and then executed by the governor. I had a bill in last year to actually remove the governor's power to declare a state of emergency. I think it should at least be substantially more limited than it is now. The governor can declare a state of emergency, I think, for up to 2 weeks. And that just seems like an awful lot of latitude for a single individual to have. I think it would be, I can see giving the governor the power to declare a state of emergency for something like 3 days, you know, and with the presumption that she can't call us into special session to do it ourselves. I mean, that's really the lawful authority, is the you know, if you look at the constitutional direction for martial law and the constitutional direction for habeas corpus, a declaration of a state of emergency really ought to come from the legislature and not from a single individual. And you can say, okay, things are so bad that you can't get the legislature into session. That's conceivable. A huge ice storm, you just can't get people into Concord to declare a state of emergency. The ability to declare for some very limited period of time, 3 days, 5 days, is not irrational. But 2 weeks, I don't think so.
We started out about the Second Amendment and the right to bear arms, and we've got, I don't know.
Well, we're working through articles. I mean, that's
Well, before you go, just a quick question. So, since most of the discussion about the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms and everything, is both federal and state, correct? So, for example, we could do that in New Hampshire, but not in New Jersey.
I'm not sure of the question.
Well, if the right to bear, we always talk about the Second Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, but it sounds like what you have said in the course of all this, and maybe I misread it, is that basically this is a state thing to determine. And the state, for example, New Hampshire is pretty loosey-goosey on it, but for example, New Jersey isn't.
Well, does New Jersey have any anything in their constitution that prohibits the state from that enumerates a right to keep and bear arms? I don't know.
Well, no, what I was getting to is all of the discussion that you hear from the news media talks about the U.S. Constitution and the Second Amendment. And yet, the states can do, have a wide range of things that bear on the right to bear arms.
That's where I think we disagree, because I am a fan of incorporation.
Of which?
Incorporation. In other words, the original 13 got together and they signed a treaty between them to establish this federal government.
Right.
And they wrote out the rules.
Right.
Those rules, all of the rights acknowledged in that treaty, including all of those in the Ninth Amendment, belong to all individuals who are within the jurisdiction, the lawful jurisdiction of this form of government, regardless of the level, state, federal, or local. This government is required to respect those rights, every single level. If one of those levels is exempt, if we have decided that this particular thing, say the right to keep and bear arms, is something that the local government or the state government can infringe, then it's not a right anymore. And we're acknowledging it's not a right, it's merely a privilege that we're delegating infringement authority to over to one level of government. If it's a right, all of this government needs to respect it. That's incorporation.
Well, let's go back to the right.
This is where we disagree, because I see the state governments and the federal government as separate from each other.
But entangled, unfortunately.
But the federal Constitution says particularly where it applies to the states, and if it has an article that does not apply to the states, it leaves the states out. For instance, the end of Article 1, Section 9 is a series of prohibitions upon the state governments by the federal constitution.
Like interfering in private contracts.
Like ex post facto law. There's a number of, so they thought about what they didn't want the states to be able to do. And the Constitution says that the powers delegated to the United States, not delegated to the United States, nor by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, remain with the states or the people respectively.
But infringing on the right to free speech is not explicitly prohibited to the states, and yet it is incorporated.
Yes, it is. Most states have prohibitions.
Yeah, but that's not in the federal constitution. That was decided at the state level.
Which?
The federal...
The prohibition of...
The First Amendment.
Right.
Certainly, states may have. Say a state was too foolish to put in the equivalent of the First Amendment into their state constitution. Would you assert that they have every authority to infringe on religion and to infringe on press and to infringe on association being a part, being a co-signer to the federal constitution, just because they didn't have it in their state constitution, are they absolved from protection of First Amendment rights?
I think it's debatable. I really do. I mean, I don't like it, but if the one of the things I think is really fascinating, and this is, I think in one sense, the enumeration of the Bill of Rights served us poorly, is that we cease to be cognizant of the rights enumerated in our state constitutions, which are far greater and far broader and far more detailed. The other thing that I think is amazingly, the other thing that I think is amazingly interesting is that by doing this, if we had not created the Federal Bill of Rights, we would all know what our protections against the state governments are, and the federal government for that matter, because if the states are, if there are protections in the state government, you know, protections against the state governments in terms of bills of rights, and therefore the states don't have those powers, then they can't delegate those powers to the general government. So really, and if you look at Article 9 of the Bill of Rights, I find it most fascinating because, okay, the enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. Using that verbiage implies a positive act by the people of retention. Where is that positive act of retention? And I would argue that positive act of retention is in the state constitutions. If the people have retained other rights, then those, they've done something somewhere. And we have a retention of rights in the state constitutions that is far broader. So the failure to enumerate everything that's in all the state constitutions doesn't disparage all the rights that are retained in the state constitutions. And because they're not all identical, I mean, you may have 10 here and 11 here and 15 over there, but between the three of them, you've got 25. Because they're not identical. And some states saw fit to protect rights that other states didn't.
So when we met a few weeks ago, you made the example of the federal constitution, the Fourth Amendment, and the New Hampshire Constitution, Article 19. And so in that case, you were saying that Article 19 goes far beyond the Fourth Amendment.
Yep.
So in that case, whichever is the most, preserves the freedom to the greatest extent, is the one that trumps it. I think the case of the prohibition, which you brought up, is that's a bit of an unusual amendment. So in that case, where that actually is a prohibition, I think, on the people or whatever, if New Hampshire had come along and said, you know what, we're not going to buy off on prohibition. We're going to put something in our state constitution that expressly allows the sale of alcohol. In that situation, because it's expressly forbidden in the federal constitution, you couldn't have that, right? You couldn't have such a...
And there's where you have the supremacy clause.
Okay. So, in the case of the right to bear arms, if somebody got along and they said, we are going to take out the Second Amendment, we are going to repeal it, just like they re-appealed prohibition, it doesn't matter, because in New Hampshire, we have that. If they went in and they said, in the Constitution, not only have we repealed the Second Amendment, but we put in another amendment which forbids the possession of weapons.
Then you'd have a problem.
That
would supersede
Trump. Only then.
Only then.
Right. And why haven't we seceded by then? Seriously.
Right. I mean, there's other things that would precipitate. But, yeah. Having to do with the military, we didn't touch on Article 25. Standing armies are dangerous to liberty and ought not be raised or kept up without the consent of the legislature. That's also echoed in the federal constitution. In Article 26, and this goes back to who did declare martial law, to whom were the militias responsible to? Were they gangs of guys who organized themselves, as a lot of people like to think? Or was there an order and to it? In all cases and at all times, the military ought to be under the strict subordination to and governed by the civil power. So you can't have a military that goes off on its own accord. It has to be under the command of the governor or the legislature. They can't just be operating under their own authority. What time is it? Okay. No, not bad.
Dan, I have a sort of a general question.
Yep.
There's a lot of confusion about what rights and privileges you have on the federal level and on the state level, and might even go down to the local level. Why do you suppose, for example, there's no discussion of the right to bear arms as regards the state constitutions are concerned? Almost everything we ever hear is always about the federal.
Because
what you're saying is the states, in many ways, override that, don't they?
They are often more explicit. I mean, the federal constitution says the federal government can't infringe on the right to keep and bear arms. And the state constitution says everybody has the right to keep and bear arms. It's a positive statement, not a negative statement. In defense of themselves, their property, and the state. So the state has a very positive, and Pennsylvania has from the get-go, had a very positive statement of the right to keep and bear arms. The federal government, the federal amendment says that it can't be infringed upon.
And so, remember, the Federalists were centralizers. It was a misnomer. The Anti-Federalists were the actual Federalists. The Federalists wanted a strong central government. They wanted the central bank, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And ever since they won, more and more power has been transferred to the federal government. And today, largely, those who want the central government realize that that's where they can work right there and get infringements on 300 million people all in one fell swoop. Why work at the state level?
But that was not, I understand you say, but that's not quite what I'm asking here. This thing started at the state level, it's a question of arms, right? We still have the same central constitution with some modifications.
Yep. This really brings up a real basic idea, and I don't know how you really transfer the thought process adequately. I've been reading a lot of books to my son, and they're all kind of apocalyptic books, you know. There's been some pandemic or whatever. But it's a very real question, and I have my views. Most people, I don't think, have a proper view. If the state were to disappear for some cause, can you have a United States? To me, the answer is obvious if you understand what the United States is. But can you have a United States without also having the states? It's a real fundamental, once you answer the question, it's a real fundamental question. To me, the answer is obvious, is no.
It's a lowercase u.
If there are no states, there are no United States. It can't be. The states have a fundamental presence on a physical territory. They are, if you will, an organic institution. The United States is a treaty among those states. If you have a table and you pull the legs out from underneath it, the table falls on the ground. And it's that kind of faulty logic where even though we've created this combined government, what they call the general government, which I think is a really great descriptor, okay? They created this general government. We have given so much intellectual credence to it that we cease to remember the importance of our state governments. We see, and you know, you look at what Hamilton was the highest of high federalists. He was the first guy that really advocated for a central bank. And yet he said the states are there to protect the people from the federal government. Should there be an exercise of ambition? He's the one who gave the battle plan for the states against the general government. As unlikely as it might be, he didn't see it, you know, he didn't see how it could ever occur. But he could not imagine it being successful. We're through the articles regarding the militia and martial law. And we have three very important articles to cover. I think we have enough time to do it. There are articles 28A and 29. And if you read Locke, remember part one, article one, very uniquely identified New Hampshire as a Lockean social contract. So it pulls in Locke's whole second treatise of government as kind of an expository on the Constitution of the state of New Hampshire. It was something that they were all familiar with, and that's why they identified it so particularly. And in Locke's second treatise of government, he describes the legislature as being the supreme power in government because it's most closely connected to the people. The people have delegated their power to the legislature to make the laws for their common society. So we have Article 28, and none of these, Article 28 and 29 have never been amended. Article 28A is a 1984 amendment coming out of convention, dealing with a particular aspect of taxation, and is a further limitation on the legislature. Article 28, no subsidy, charge, tax, impost, or duty shall be established, fixed, laid, or levied under any pretext whatever. So they're being pretty explicit. Without the consent of the people or their representatives in the legislature or authority derived from that body. So can any agency levy a fee to determine what a fee should be?
Unless the legislature authorizes.
Can they do that?
It didn't say they couldn't.
Under Locke, you have the non-delegation doctrine. They do not have the authority to give that power to other bodies. Now, it does say authority derived from that body, but You did not have an executive agency in this state until the 1830s. That was fish and game. So when they say, or authority derived from that body, they could not have possibly have been referring to giving authority to some state agency, because they didn't have the concept of state agencies. That was not in the gray matter of American government. What we do have in New Hampshire is a number of subordinate legislatures. We have the county delegation, which is a subordinate legislature. The general court tells the county delegation what types of laws they can make, how they must make the budget, and that county delegation serves as a legislature for the county. So that subordinate legislature has authority derived from the legislature. The towns in New Hampshire are political subdivisions of the state, unlike Massachusetts, which is a commonwealth. The citizens, the inhabitants of that town, are a subordinate legislature. If it's a city form of government, the city council is a legislature subordinate to the general court. The general court tells them what kinds of laws they may make, and in this case, what kinds of taxes they may raise. But they cannot make any taxes that the legislature has not authorized them to do so.
So the towns that have two groups, one the town and one the school system.
The school systems are another subordinate, or the inhabitants of the school district are another subordinate legislature.
The inhabitants, so they can create a school district or not?
I believe there's a presumption in state law that even if you are a single town, you have to create a school district. But you have subordinate legislatures to whom the general court, the legislature of the state, can give the authority to raise a tax. But no agency should have the power to institute a fee or to raise a fee or do whatever. This last term, we gave Fish and Game the power to set their own fees. I think that's first of all, I think it's unconstitutional, but it's also very dangerous, which is why it's unconstitutional.
But you think now that the legislature has given the towns the authority or maybe the responsibility to have two separate structures?
Yes.
Has that ever been debated recently? Or?
Not recently, no. Probably not for a century.
What was the rationale for having two separate?
I don't know. I cannot tell you. Specialization, probably. I cannot imagine why you would think you needed to have a school district as well as a town. It probably happened as schools got larger and larger. I mean, schools now, certainly monetarily, and really, in terms of staff, far outclass any town.
And they chew up most of the money.
Yep.
And 10 times the people come to the small one as opposed to the school.
Yep.
And nobody has suggested that there's something out of whack there.
Oh yeah, it's been suggested. Nobody knows quite what to do about it, but it's
well, the solution. I mean, that's simple. You make just one rather than two.
Well,
Different constituencies, though. I have a theory on the general, but in to that specific question, for example, in our town, we have one town government and two school districts covering two different constituencies. So how do you, we've got a regional high school and then the town's school district, and they overlap, but they're not the same set. So how would you get all of the respective constituencies to the same need.
Well, we in our town, for example, we typically get, I'd say, 150 people to the town meeting.
That's not what he's saying, though. What he's saying is that if you have a multi-town school district, and you do so because of the efficiencies of scale to build a school at lower cost per student, then you have two towns whose inhabitants are members of the school district, and those inhabitants are only members of one, are only the legislature of each of the towns respectively. So it doesn't work where you have a multi-town school district. Now, Fremont has at least a grade school and middle school that is a single town district. There is no reason that we couldn't do it all under one auspice. Probably the reason is because we now have school boards, and school boards are an executive body independent of the selectmen.
But in our town, we have a local school, and then we send our kids to Keene, which is another whole set of things, and then we have our non-school thing. We only have two legal entities, one being the school committee, so-called, and one being the town, so-called.
Yeah.
But even though the only control we have over the students we send is we negotiate a fee. So that's a case where...
Which is handled through the school district.
That's correct.
Right.
The
question is, I guess, as we made education a more substantial venture, would you want the selectmen governing both the town and the school district?
It couldn't do any worse than the school.
Well, that's a different issue. There's a philosophical thing there. Do you want the selectmen doing the job of the school district as well? It's a part-time position. It would be far less a part-time position because, you think of all the work the selectmen do, you think of all the work that the members of the school board do, and you'd have one body of people having to do everything, and selectmen are set up to be boards of three. There's no five-member selectmen boards, I don't believe. So,
we get five.
You have five? Yep. Okay, well then, there's no reason not to. I mean, you must have a special charter. But it's very clear from Article 28 that only the legislature is supposed to be, that the legislature is in charge of taxes. So if it raises the conflict, for instance, of the judiciary telling the legislature how they have to fund schools, if only the legislature raises any tax or fee, aka Claremont. Article 28A was designed to hold the legislature accountable. The state shall not mandate or assign any new or expanded modified programs or responsibilities to any political subdivision, town or county, in such a way as to necessitate additional local expenditures by the political subdivision, unless such programs or responsibilities are fully funded by the state, or unless such programs or responsibilities are approved for funding by a vote of the local legislative body of the political subdivision.
So if we wanted to have like one body in our town, we would go to the legislature and get them to do whatever it is.
We could do that.
There's nothing.
I don't see, certainly constitutionally there's nothing prohibiting it. It's all a matter of statute.
My theory on the general question, when some people complain about property taxes in New Hampshire. You know, and then the first comeback is, well, we don't have any broad-based, you know, sales or income tax. But to illustrate that point, I bring up a quote from Mark Twain from, you know, 150 years ago. A quote from one of his books, and shortened, goes something like, the fool saith, do not put all your eggs in one basket, which is a manner of saying, spread your attentions, yada, yada. The wise man says, put all your eggs in that one basket, and then watch that basket. It is so difficult to keep up in, you know,
that's a good point.
The other states with all fees and taxes and everything else. It's 5 cents here and 10 cents there and $1.50 over there. And you can't keep up with it. In New Hampshire, you pay your property taxes twice a year. It's right there in front of you.
Furthermore, and I think this is the most important aspect, is having given the keys of the kingdom to the towns, okay, the school tax and all your local taxes, when people say their property taxes are too high, they have only one, well, other than the county taxes, they have only one individual to look at, themselves, because they have voted to spend that money. There's a great way to lower your taxes in New Hampshire. Vote to spend less money.
Right. Show up at the town meeting. And that's why separating the school districts was such a good idea. Nobody shows up at those meetings.
Oh, no, I know why it was done. The last school committee meeting in our town, they wanted to basically double the size of the school. And so I sent out an EDDM, Every Door Direct Mail. And when we got to the meeting, it turned out we had, 225 people there, and the moderator announced that had never happened before in the history of the town. And of course, it not only didn't get its two-thirds vote, it didn't get a majority. But that's a hell of a way of going about doing it.
I
don't know what it is. Everybody thinks of the town meeting as the one they got to go to. The school meeting, there's that.
Mm-hmm. That's only about the kids. If you don't have kids, why would you go? But on top of that, if you want an exercise in the down that train of thought, in the mid 90s, we created SB2 towns, mm-hmm. SB2 form of government, and with really good intentions, because you no longer had to attend town meeting to vote. And so it enabled people who, it was made more convenient for people who worked or who were busy on Saturdays or whatever to vote on all these appropriations. My first term in the legislature, 2000, it was probably not more than 6 years after SB2 was created. One of the things we did was, for capital appropriations, drop the majority for approval from 2/3 to 60%. And do you know what the justification for that was?
Nobody shows up.
To make it easier to pass, yep. to make it easier for the districts to spend money. The problem we had with SB2 towns is they weren't spending money.
To be fair, though, there are downsides to each. We're SB2. There are downsides to each one. There is no perfect town meeting.
There is no perfect town meeting. Because SB2 towns tend to get even less participation at the deliberative session, and our warrant articles can go horribly awry.
Uh-huh.
I have tried. I would like to see us put a quorum on amending a quorum specification. 10% of the registered voters or something have to appear at the town meeting so as to be able to amend a warrant article.
So again, can I just finish off? If I wanted to push for combining the two entities, that would be something I'd have to get the town to sort of buy into it, then it's got to really go to legislature. Would there be, would the legislature care whether a little town wanted to go through the other? I know the school unions would fight like hell, but I mean, does the legislature give a damn? There's nothing.
Oh, certain factions would fight it tooth and nail.
Right, absolutely. But there's no inherent thing within the legislature.
Other than that's not the way we do things around here.
Well.
I mean, I'm sorry, you would find a lot of inertial problems.
Oh, there's always that.
But Article 28A is designed to keep the legislature from imposing programs. That's what it says. That if we come up with any new programs, that the state has to pay for it unless the local body votes to pay for it. That's designed to inhibit the legislature from creating new mandates.
Unfunded mandates
upon the towns. That was used for a long time to thwart mandatory kindergarten. Article 29, I think, is one of the most fantastic articles of the Constitution. It's one of those, it's right up there with the first 10 articles and the articles on redress, which comes shortly thereafter. The power of suspending the laws or the execution of them ought never to be exercised. Now remember, we talked about the word ought. Ought is the moral imperative, duty, the highest order of instruction in a document of this type. The power of suspending the laws or the execution of them ought never to be exercised but by the legislature or authority derived therefrom. So that you're talking to the subordinate legislatures. To be exercised in such particular cases as only the legislature shall expressly provide for. And there's no mention of the subordinate legislatures there. Suspension of law. One of the things we've seen, particularly, beginning in the early 19th century and accelerating in the 20th century, is the penchant of the judiciary to suspend law, to, in a particular case, state that a law is unconstitutional and thereby prohibit the further exercise of the law. But if as Locke says, the legislature is supreme, and you look at the words of our Constitution in Part 2, Article 4, Article 2, the supreme legislative power within this state shall be vested in the Senate and House of Representatives, each of which will have a negative on the other. Federal Constitution says, all legislative power granted herein shall be vested in a Congress consisting of a Senate and a House of Representatives. If you have all legislative power, can any other individual or body commit a legislative act? Simple answer is no. Now, the way I look at the Constitution, the Bill of Rights is the skeleton. It provides the basic framework of the Constitution. The form of government is the muscles. It gives that Constitution form and shape. And it describes exactly how the various branches of government are going to be populated, how the members are going to be chosen, how it's all going to put together and work amongst each other.
But if
Part 1, Article 29 says that only the legislature ought to ever suspend or execute any law, and any law ought to be executed only as the legislature specifically provides for.
But if the legislature passes two laws that are in conflict, those are the only ones that go to the judiciary, aren't they?
No. No, because the judiciary has... I want you to think about it. This is... I never have gone through the comparison of powers of government. The legislature has an immense amount of power. We make all the laws. Only we can remove other members from other branches. And the House of Representatives has the most power in that only we can initiate impeachments, or money bills. But in this body of vast power, there's 400 members. So each of us only exercises 1/400th of that power. The Senate has a little less power in that they can't initiate money bills or impeachments. And there's 24 of them. So though that body has a little less power, each of them holds 1/24th of the power. You move to the executive, and that's divided in two. Now the executive has less power. It can't create the laws. It has to do what the legislature says. It can't remove any members of the legislature. And it's divided into two parts. The governor holds half of the power, and the executive council holds the other half, and that's divided into five members. So the members of the executive hold 50% and 10% of the power of the executive. In the courtroom, the judge has plenary power. That means all the power in the room. But his power doesn't go beyond the walls of that room. Only the legislature can suspend or execute any law. If a judge in his courtroom, having plenary power, determines a law to be unconstitutional, can he extend that ruling outside of his courtroom?
Obviously not. Unless the body outside the courtroom accepts it.
Or eventually agrees with it. The government is designed to be messy, to be slow, sluggish, so as you don't have it overrunning the people. The best example of a constitutional interplay between the legislature and the courts occurred in the 1780s. It's billed as the first activist court decision, or first activist court. The legislature had passed a bill called the 10-pound Act. Now, at that time, in civil suits, you had a right to trial by jury no matter what the value. Because the economy was crummy, it took a lot of time and effort to get to court. The legislature passed a bill that said if you had a controversy less than 10 pounds, you could go to the local justice of the peace.
Ten
British pounds. So obviously this is in conflict with Article 20. Well, there was one case where a fellow had bought a pair of shoes and had not paid for the shoes. You know, he just ended up not having the money, economy being what it is. And the shop owner took him to court over the 10-pound, I think it was 9-pound something. And so it was under the 10-pound limit. And the guy who had, quote-unquote, purchased the shoes, the Justice of the Peace found against him. And they appealed it. The next level of appeal at that time was called the Inferior Court. So he appealed to the Inferior Court of Rockingham, and they went through the case. It actually turned out that he had, in fact, bartered part of the cost away. He had traded a shirt and something else for the shoes, and so he didn't owe the full price of the shoes. But as the judge of the Inferior Court was about to pronounce his judgment, affirming that of the Justice of the Peace, the gentleman's attorney stood up and said, "Is the 10-pound Act is unconstitutional per Part 1, Article 20. The judge concurred. He said, "You're right, it is unconstitutional. I find in favor of the plaintiff, and I arrest my decision." So he put a stop on his own order. So he made the judgment according to the law, and then arrested the judgment. Well, this then continued for the next 18 months. People would go to a justice of the peace, there'd be a judgment, it would be appealed to the inferior court. At the near the conclusion of the inferior court case or hearing, one of the plaintiffs would yell it's unconstitutional, and the judge of the inferior court would award it, make his decision, and then arrest his award. And this made the legislature very angry. But it continued for 18 months. Never did the judiciary presume to be able to erase the law from the books. Their actions only held within their courtroom.
Did they have too many lawyers back in the 1700s?
Well, at least not bad lawyers. So, after 18 months, the legislature attempted to impeach a number of the judges of the inferior court. The impeachment failed because a majority of the legislature agreed that they were right, and so they repealed the law. But that is a proper interplay. You have a constitutional conflict. The judges kept saying it's unconstitutional over and over and over again. And finally, the legislature wised up and said, you know what, you're right. And they repealed the law.
But doesn't that go back to the question I asked earlier? The only time the judiciary can do really much of anything is only when they find a conflict in the law.
Oh, absolutely.
If they have no conflict in the law, the judiciary is null and void.
Well, not null and void. In terms of the constitutionality of a law, they cannot arrive at an opinion unless they have a case before them. They can't just ethereally declare a law unconstitutional. It has to be a result of a judicial process.
You see that from the Supreme Court all the time.
They're not going to
touch an issue until it comes
right
before them through channels.
Now, we have a special power in the legislature of New Hampshire, I believe some of the other legislatures as well, of the states, in that if we are uncomfortable with a proposed bill, we can ask an opinion of the courts and require them to tell us whether they think the law we are about to pass is unconstitutional.
Can you require them?
Absolutely.
Really?
Yes.
Ooh.
Part 2, Article...
That doesn't mean it's right.
No.
It's true.
Well, and there are times when, you know, people will do that. I mean, there was, I can't remember what it was, then Senator Prescott, or still Senator Prescott, asked an opinion of the court on a particular bill. Bad idea. You know what their opinion is going to be, and you know you're not going to agree with it, so why ask them in the first place?
Because he's a lawyer.
No, he's not. He's an engineer.
Good.
Let's see, where is it? Judges, Article 74, which judges to give opinion when? Each branch of the legislature, so we don't have to do this jointly, it doesn't require both branches to, say, pass a resolution. Each branch of the legislature, as well as the governor and council, shall have the authority to require the opinion of the justice of the Supreme Court upon important questions of law and upon solemn occasions.
I've missed that.
So, prior to something going out, we can require them to tell us what they think about it, which is extremely powerful. It should keep us from, should be able to keep us from stepping in stuff.
And pins them down, yeah, too.
Well, except that because they do not arise out of controversy, opinions thus asked do not constitute precedent.
There's not a line about women, isn't there?
Right.
Reserve the right to change their...
Yeah.
But the important thing, you never want to restrict lawyers from arguing. That's the one law that's never violated.
Well, it gets them out of the way.
Yes.
Put them off
that's
the court.
What I was saying.
But, you know, so think about Article 29. Does the New Hampshire judiciary have the power? Well, recently we have Judge Tuck. Judge Tuck, last, well, let's see, 2019 2015 session, we passed a law regarding school funding. That, you know, we said how much each student was going to get that was going to follow them. But we also said, on top of that, no school can have their funding increase by more than 8% from the previous year. Judge Tuck has just found that unconstitutional. Now, what he does with it is another question. Now, if he just finds that unconstitutional, I may disagree with him, but I don't have a problem with it. However, if he then instructs the Department of Education to send money to the Dover School District, he is countermanding law made by the legislature. He is suspending the law, and in fact, he is enacting a law, executing a law, without the authority of the legislature. And what happens if the Department of Education makes that disbursement and the governor signs it? How does money come out of the treasury? Part 2, Article 56. Disbursements from the treasury. No money shall be issued out of the treasury of this state and disposed of, parentheses, except as such may be approved for the redemption of bills of credit or treasurer's notes or for the payment of interest thereon. So we've already agreed to pay it. But by the warrant under the hand of the governor for the time being, and by the advice and consent of counsel, for the necessary support and defense of the state, and for the necessary protection and preservation of the inhabitants thereof, agreeably to the acts of the general court. So, if we have said, thou shalt not give anybody more than an 8% increase, and somebody actually writes a check for more than that 8% increase, what have they done?
Violated the law.
They violated the Constitution. When in 2006 we had redistricted, and let's go back to 2002. We had districted the state, and the Supreme Court did not like our apportionment of constituents. They thought we had too great a variance, and so in the end, they brought in somebody from South Carolina, I think, north of South Carolina, and districted the state for us, ending up with huge legislative districts in some cases, to get, you know, dead on the average amongst all the, I think we had 80, instead of the 116 districts or something that we have now, we had like 80. You think about what they did. They told the Secretary of State not to execute the law as we had passed it. And then they, in effect, passed a law themselves by districting the state. They did it again in 2006. We passed a law, said, this is what the ballots have to look like. This, you know, Republicans on the left, Democrats on the right, alphabetical order, starting with A. And they decided there's this thing called supremacy, which there is no evidence to support in New Hampshire.
Margaret, you're massing.
But regardless, they told the Secretary of State not to publish the ballots in the manner that we had prescribed. What does it say there in Article 29?
We're waiting with bated breath to tell us what happened.
To be exercised in such particular cases as only the legislature shall expressly provide for. They told the Secretary of State not to publish the ballots as we had prescribed, and then they told him to publish the ballots in a different manner. And that's how we began with having the alphabet begin with something other than A. Every year, the first letter of the alphabet is chosen by lottery. every election. That is a blatant violation of Part 1, Article 29. That's how I got into this thing altogether in the first place. Up to the end, then I was just another state rep, so to speak. The reason I went into the legislature was to fight the unwarranted removal of children by DCYF.
By what?
By Child Protective Services, Department of Children, Youth, and Families. And in 2006, I actually got a law passed that introduced due process back into the process. It instituted the idea of a warrant. If they arrived at your door, they had to tell you why they were there, and they had to inform you that you didn't have to let them in unless they had a court order. Now, it's not quite a warrant, but it's the same thing as a warrant. It requires the same level of scrutiny. Got all that passed. There are a couple of other aspects to it. They couldn't introduce evidence less than 5 days before a hearing, or either party could request a continuance to a date certain not more than 10 days away.
Why do you hate children?
Yeah. So, got that passed, and it has affected things somewhat. But I then said, you know, God, if you're going to keep me here, you've got to give me something else to do. Well, then we had the debacle of the order of names on the ballot. And I found Part 1, Article 29. And I started arguing on the HRA listserv that they can't do this. It's a violation of the Constitution. My arguments were adequate to get the House of Representatives and the Senate to call themselves back into session without benefit of the governor or the Speaker of the House or the President of the Senate. We called ourselves back into session, and the Senate passed an order telling the Secretary of State to publish the ballots the way we said. It came to the House. I couldn't be there that day. I had to be away on other important business. I had a project in Ohio. Had to go. They amended after the Senate handed them the bill, the order, they amended it with words from my emails. I hope that if I had been there, I would have had the presence of mind to say no. I don't know. Unfortunately, the Senate, having told them, don't change it, had recessed themselves and gone home, adjourned. The House amended it, and there was nobody to concur with the amendment. And so the measure failed. You were that close!
But you said that...
And the Secretary of State wanted the order as well. He wanted to be told to do it the way we said.
But the Secretary of State still could not spend the money redoing it.
He has a certain budget for printing the ballots. The ballots had not been printed yet. The question was, what were they going to look like when he printed them? And he did not have the courage to risk going to jail.
Well, I'm waiting for a reverse alphabetical order to work for 100 years and make it even. So what you're saying is that it depends as to whether the judiciary can spend money.
Literally, they can. If the legislature has the guts to stand up and say no, what is the legislature? The Constitution recognizes the legislature as the grand inquest of the state. It's in our role as initiating impeachments. Grand inquest of the state means a grand jury. It is our job to watch the other departments of the state to make sure that all of their members are acting according to law and constitution. And when necessary, when they are guilty of bribery, corruption, malpractice, or maladministration, to remove them from office permanently and forever.
So in this ballot situation that you described, the legislature has prescribed an order, this is how the ballots will be printed. The judiciary has said no. So there's an impasse there. So you come back, it comes back, you call back.
Well, it wasn't just an impasse because they then ordered the Secretary of State to do something else.
Okay, so they do that, so you say, oh yeah, and you get everybody back together. Let's say, in this case, there was nobody to concur with the amendment. Let's say that the legislature had passed that, which means basically we're going back to the way it was, we're going back to the old order. So now, you have your opinion, he's already said that your opinion is wrong. You come back and said, oh yeah. How does that resolve itself?
The Secretary of State said he would do what we ordered.
So had the legislature had any calls, they would have
gotten... we did not lack... that was the one moment in history where we didn't lack the testosterone. We simply lacked the presence of mind.
Okay, you need a legislation to actually pass by both houses. But in that case, so...
We would have told the court to go take a flying leap.
So if he printed the ballots, he said, I'm going to go along with the legislature, I'm going to print the ballots. I mean...
He would have gone along with the legislature.
He would have gone along with the legislature. But he didn't want to go along with them the first time?
He had received a court order more current than the legislative order.
Okay.
He wanted the legislature to reaffirm their position for him. Thank you.
So what would happen if the judge came in and said, well, they're in the wrong... and he was to reaffirm his...
Hopefully we would have then impeached him.
So that's the ultimate resolution.
That's the ultimate resolution, yeah.
Can you give the Secretary of State a standing order that what we said is what we believe, and until we tell you otherwise, we don't concur with the court?
I don't know that you would be wise to do that in a general sense. Because you don't know what what the legislature's order or what the court's order might say.
But it requires the Secretary of State at least to come back and say,
really?
So what do you think now? And if you can't right this minute tell him, he has to revert to what you told him previously until you tell him otherwise.
Depends on who's the stronger person, basically.
Yeah.
That always ends up that way.
And one of my hopes is to someday get the legislature to hitch up its pants.
Hmm.
Comes down to where they fall. That's true everywhere.
Well, it has to. We suffer from a century, maybe two centuries, almost two centuries of miseducation as to the relative powers of the legislature. One of the things you like to hear people say and is that, you know, the three co-equal branches of government. Well, there's nothing in the constitutions and absolutely the opposite in Locke's treatise on government about the equality of the branches of government.
Our judiciary is the low man on the totem.
It is. And you know, you look at separate in the one of the things is every time you see the three powers of government, it's always listed legislative, executive, judicial. And that's not accidental. Especially when you know everything ties back to Locke, who said the legislature is supreme. And actually the judiciary didn't even get honorable mention under Locke because they were part of the executive.
But I would prefer the perception that they are co-equal to the perception that, let's face it, the judiciary would prefer that some are subservient.
Well, so would I. But we have opposite perceptions. We have Part 1, Article 37. In the government of this state, the three essential powers of government, essential powers thereof, to wit, the legislative, executive, and judicial, ought to be kept as separate from and independent of each other as the nature of free government will admit. Which indicates they are not completely and cannot be completely independent? Or is this consistent with that chain of connection that binds the whole fabric of this Constitution, of the Constitution, in one indissoluble bond of unity and amity? There is nothing that indicates them to be separate and co-equal. One of the things I did when we were having hearings about 2012, we had a constitutional amendment to propose to take away the court's power of making rules. I had one, Paul Mirsky had one, and we had a number of other judicial bill hearings that day. I walked into the committee room. I wasn't the first, I was about the second or third testator. And I took a silver round, you know, 1 ounce silver coin, if you will. And I put it on the table and I said, this is a challenge. I said, I do not want to hear anyone use the phrase co-equal branches of government. There is nothing in our Constitution that implies the three powers of government are co-equal. And this silver round goes to the first individual who can show me otherwise in our Constitution. And I left it on the hearing table all day long. And they kept here. They were had hearings until 7 o'clock that night.
Isn't that a prop?
It's not in on the floor of the House. It's in committee. I'm smarter than that. We're not allowed to use props on the floor.
And I'm going to make a very cynical people.
And. Immediately, and I had already prepped Senator Groen, who was Senator Carson, Senator Groen was on that committee, and I had already prepped Senator Groen as to what Article 37 says, and Senator Carson leans over and says, doesn't Article 37, Senator Groen says, no. and then all the judges were forced to sit that day and stare at that silly silver round as they testified, and one of them started to say something and you could see him visibly stop himself, and nobody that day mentioned co-equal branches of government.
I wish I'd gotten that day on video.
Okay, we're getting more cynical by the month.
You're supposed to be.
Yeah.
That's the whole thing. One of the reasons we have constitutions is because we're not supposed to trust the government.
The left of the new senator.
Are you implying she trusts the government? I mean that's the whole reason this is here is to keep the goobers in government in check.
And the larger their individual constituencies, the less I trust them.
That's one of the beauties of New Hampshire. Actually, we actually have a serious problem at the federal level, and that is it is the size of the constituencies. General Washington said one thing during the debates on the Constitution for the United States. He said, 30,000 is representation, 40,000 is tyranny, referring to the number of constituents per legislator. That being the case, what is 750,000? Okay? We are at a state I question the ability to govern the United States as a democratic republic, because right now our representatives have between 750,000 constituents per each, and the only way to remedy that would be to increase the federal legislature from 435 to 4,000 or 5,000. which would be dysfunctional in its own right. So I question, you know, and this is something our founders were afraid of. They did not articulate it the way I think it's played out. They feared the size of the republic in terms of geography and being, you know, one end being too remote from the other or from the capital. But certainly the size of the republic has gotten to a point that it's hard to govern in a republican manner.
Are you against immigration? Is that what you're telling us?
No, I'm saying...
But
this is serious. One of the reasons New Hampshire works as well as it does is because our level of representation in the House of Representatives is actually similar to what it was for most states during the founding period. We had a representative for every 300 people, the first 150 and then everything thereafter. Okay? Other states typically had a legislator for every 4,000 or 5,000 people. We have a representative for every 3,500. We're still at a constitutional period level of representation. We're the only state that is. Although some of the states like Idaho and Wyoming are not far behind. They have much smaller legislatures, but they've got half the population.
But then states like California, I believe, are closer to
the federal level.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, and California is actually looking at splitting into three smaller republics, mm-hmm. and well, they should.
Plus Jefferson.
But it's never going to pass.
Because you need your government's permission to be free.
Well, I can agree they ought to be split up, but think about the political implications of it, never going to happen.
I don't think the political implications are that large.
Why are you going to treat Democratic states as
I don't know that you would. The northern faction, you'd have two more Democratic, generally Democratic, and one probably generally Republican. It's got San Francisco, but the rest of the northern area is very, very conservative.
Yeah, the Senate would increase, but the
you
House...
You've got to get well north of the Bay to get into the conservative area.
True.
Up in wine country and things like that.
Well, no, further than that, but... Then you've got, you know, Humboldt and all the pot
drugs. There's no population up there. There's tens of millions south of there. I don't know. I don't think it's possible.
We're back to secession. Just let them leave.
Well, do we have the right to secede?
Does the federal government have the authority
to stop it?
To prohibit it? I don't see anything.
There's nothing in it, nothing regarding it in the Constitution.
Well, we've got a little town of 1,200 and we got problems. So I don't know that that's a sign to tell you the truth. People, they always populated by people, most of whom never want to be wrong. And once you end up in a situation where most people don't want to be wrong, it's very hard to get much done.
The treaty, and I know I understand you're branching off, but the original treaty between the original 13 was a voluntary union. If you were one of the original 13, would you have agreed to it if one of the terms was you're enslaved forever, and not just you, but all future generations for eternity?
I don't think so.
Freedom is a tough thing.
See if I can find Jefferson. This is, I think, one of the most amazing quotes. I think I've presented it to you before. It's a letter from the legislature of New Hampshire to President Jefferson in 1808. So it's shortly after the Louisiana Purchase. And part of what they're doing is lambasting him for Louisiana Purchase and for his embargo on trade with France.
Louisiana Purchase would be like
1804. Yeah, pretty sure. So, I want you to understand how you have Jefferson and Madison's Kentucky and Virginia resolutions regarding state sovereignty in 1798. They were introduced identically. They were 3 or 4 pages long. By the time the legislatures were done, they were a paragraph or two. They each one focused on different aspects of the original introduced resolution. You would not be able to look at the two resolutions and say, gee, these came from the same document. I mean, they were just that, and that's what legislatures do. They tend to sanitize things. So you have to understand that this letter from the legislature of New Hampshire to President Jefferson has been sanitized. The legislature of New Hampshire being assembled and realizing that the present is to our country a momentous period, and sensible that the bond of confederation which connects the independent states of America is strengthened by unanimity alone between the National Council and the state legislatures, and not ignorant that the present crisis in our national affairs has excited the present humors that occasionally afflict the national system and mar the fair prospect of our institutions. So they're kind of giving them a slap across the back of the head, and they go on and they're, you know, they go on and they say, Louisiana Purchase was unconstitutional, but it cost less money and no bloodshed compared to a war. So good job. You know, it real backhanded compliment. But you think about that. This is after the Constitution of the United States. They consider the Union of the States to be a confederation. They consider the states to be independent states. And that the only thing that held us together with the national government was unanimity of purpose.
Nice hope, isn't it?
But that is what the legislature thought at the time.
Sanitized.
That's the takeaway. That bold statement had been softened and massaged to something that would be acceptable to the president. I mean, just think about what that says. Think about what happened. Think about Part 1, Article 1. All government of right originates in the people, is founded in consent, and instituted for the general good. Founded in consent, basic premise of American government. At the conclusion of the Civil War, when Confederates were repatriated at the point of a gun, was there any longer any government by consent? I mean, to me, it's a startling thought. I understand the thinking that went, you know, what was going on in Lincoln's head, but it's not unlike where you get to a point in some institutions that preserving the institution is more important than the purpose of the institution.
That's called the UN.
It's called most things that men create, you know.
And become self-perpetuating.
Right. I mean, Christianity, in my opinion, is a beautiful religion. But when it becomes about continuing the traditions and preserving the building, rather than about the purpose of the religion, do you have the religion anymore? When preserving the Union becomes about keeping the Confederation, the general government intact, rather than that government being a voluntary confederation of the states, do you have that institution anymore? If there are no states, is there a United States?
parties to a contract don't exist anymore.
Do you have a contract? I mean, and I think in many ways it is where we are in, and you think of not to Tocqueville, Taylor, Andrew Taylor, the average life of the world's greatest civilizations is 200 years. Where are we?
200 years.
Yeah, 240. We're beyond the average. We are following right down the cycle that he prescribed. Tyranny to faith, faith to liberty, liberty to abundance, abundance to complacency, complacency to dependency, apathy, then apathy to dependency, and dependency back to tyranny.
I have that quote in my book of quotes and multiple citations. It's there's a question from whom it emanated, but I have
Tyler,
four or five different citations. I'll include that in the video commentary.
Taylor specified that in 1776.
Ooh.
Now, given the pendency of the election, we're going to do next one.
I would say the next class is the last Sunday in October, just a bare week or so before the, I counted it out today, I think it comes out to be October 30th. Yes, because originally it was going to be the 31st and people were complaining, but we moved from Monday to Sunday and it's the 30th.